I think the question is agreed by a majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed. Proposed resolution under the Occupational Deafness Compensation Ordinance. Members who wish to speak on the motion will please press the request to speak button. And I'll call upon the Secretary for Labour and Welfare to speak and move the motion. Secretary for Labour and Welfare. Madam Deputy, I move that the resolution as printed on the agenda be passed. The purpose of this resolution is to increase the amounts of four compensation items stipulated in the Occupational Deafness Compensation Ordinance, or ODCO. The ODCO provides for the payment of compensation to persons who suffer from noise-induced deafness, or OD persons, by reason of employment in the noisy occupations specified in the ordinance. According to the established mechanism, the maximum and minimum sums for calculating the amount of compensation for permanent incapacity under ODCO, together with the levels of compensation under the Employees' Compensation Ordinance, ECO, and the Pneumoconiosis and Mesothelioma Compensation Ordinance, are adjusted every 2 years where appropriate. The maximum and minimum sums for calculating the amount of compensation for permanent incapacity under ODCO are adjusted in the light of the wage movement reflected by the nominal wage index, or NWI, in the relevant period according to the mechanism. Based on information from the Census and Statistics Department, NWI recorded a cumulative increase of 8.78% in the period from 2014 to 2015. We propose to increase the amounts of these two compensation items by 8.78% in line with the aforesaid wage movement. Specifically, the proposed revisions include increasing the maximum sum for calculating the amount of compensation for permanent incapacity for employees aged under 40 from $2.50272 million to $2.72256 million. For employees aged 40 to under 56, from $1.87704 million to $2.04192 million. And for employees aged 56 or above, from $1.25136 to $1.36128. As for the minimum sum for calculating the amount of compensation for permanent incapacity, we propose to increase the amount from $426,880 to $464,360. Moreover, under ODCO, any person who has at any time been entitled to compensation for permanent incapacity may apply to the Occupational Deafness Compensation Board, or ODCB, for the direct payment of reimbursement or of expenses reasonably incurred in the acquisition, fitting, repair or maintenance of hearing assistive devices, with a view to enhancing the protection accorded by the HAD financing scheme for OD persons. Starting from this exercise, we propose to adopt the CPIA, a price movement index, as an indicator to adjust the amounts of two compensation items where appropriate, namely the financing limit for first-time applications for HADs and the aggregate financing limit. This draws reference from the established mechanism for adjusting the maximum amounts of the cost of supplying, fitting, repairing and renewing a prosthesis or surgical appliance under ECO. According to information from CNSD, CPIA recorded a cumulative increase of 9.82% in the period from 2014 to 2015. We propose to increase the amounts of these two compensation items by 9.82% in line with the aforementioned price movement. That is, increasing the financing limit for first-time applications for HADs from $15,000 to $16,470 and the aggregate financing limit from $52,000 to $57,110. The Labour Advisory Board and the ODCB have endorsed the above proposal, and the Legislative Council Panel on Manpower have supported the proposal. We propose that the revised level of compensation and financing limits should take effect from the 1st of April 2017. I hope members will support and pass the resolution so as to enhance the protection for OD persons as early as possible. Thank you, President.
I now propose a question to you, and that is that the motion moved by the Secretary for Labor and Welfare be passed. Dr. K.K. Kwok. President, I don't think people are interested in these workers with occupational deafness, and I'd like to talk about the impacts of the adjusted level compensation levels to them. And those with permanent incapacity, the levels has increased for compensation. But in terms of the definition of permanent incapacity, the Labor Department has not been adopting any scientific approach. So a lot of workers with permanent incapacity could not obtain the sum or compensation for permanent incapacity. Very few workers can actually enjoy the compensation for permanent incapacity. Of course, for the government to change its approach, the labor and healthcare sectors have been asking for the government to take it on board for a long time, but it has not been done. The Labor Department's compensation mechanism is outdated. It was stuck in the 1950s. Well, even though Mr. Wong Kok-heng is not here, the definitions of loss of one or two limbs is still adopted. There is no scientific approach on the extent of loss of capacity. This is actually nothing new. When you look at the U.S. Healthcare Center or other healthcare organizations in Europe, they have established much more objective and scientific approaches on different extents to loss of capacity. Unfortunately, the Labor Department is still adopting methodologies from 50 years ago. Those who are eligible for compensations under the ODCO are mostly construction workers, which is most fortunate. They have been using machinery such as drills due to their lack of knowledge or the employer's lack of knowledge. After the so many years, they have lost their hearing. And compared with mesothelioma or pneumoconiosis patients, they are relatively lucky, and the loss of hearing is similar to pneumoconiosis in a way that the effects are cumulative, and it is due to unprotected work or lengthy unprotected work, especially when using machineries. We will see more and more of that in the future since we have more infrastructure projects and we rely heavily on aviation. A lot of workers who live near the airport still do not have protective gears or mufflers for their ears. So I think the Labor Department should look at that. So instead of talking about compensation levels, I want to talk about the hearing aid. The new compensation level is 16,470. Perhaps the secretary does not know the prices of these aid. A lot of compensated workers received no more than $15,000 in the past. Even if you exceed that amount, no extra compensation would be made. So workers were forced to choose hearing aid that cost less than $15,000. Now for hearing aid nowadays, I can just open a website of any supplier. The cheapest one is around $4,500, but they would not use it because this kind of portable hearing aid are extremely old, and they are also wired, and these old hearing aid would emit buses or whizzes, and the acoustic function is inferior. And you can see elderly people are wearing very small or induction or in-ear hearing aid. These hearing aid usually adopts digital systems. Advantages include automatic volume adjustment, less background noise, and the design is comfortable to wear. This type of higher quality automatic hearing aid costs $23,000 per year, and for 2 years the cost is $35,000. The most expensive models for one year it's $55,000, and for both years it's $100,000. Well, some people might say, as long as I have a car, why do I need a Rolls Royce? Of course, if they do have a choice, they would rather not put on any hearing aid. Who wants to use hearing aid? Of course not. But for them, for the permanently deaf, of course they don't want to put on the hearing aid every day. And they still have to choose models less than 16.47 thousand, unless they are really rich. But if they're rich, they wouldn't be construction workers. So they are forced to buy inferior sets. I hope the government can understand their plight. I hope that the Labor Department or the Secretary can put on the hearing aid themselves. If you have an elderly family member, you can ask them to try. They do not want your money, in fact. The government should give them a reasonable and functioning ear set based on the extent of damage. Hong Kong is an advanced society, and we are talking about digital technologies all the time. But the ear sets you allow them to buy are not digital. They can only buy the cheapest model because they only get $16,400. So they can forget about better models unless they are rich. For grassroots workers who are not well off, they have to use whatever is given. So I want to tell the Secretary that even if you give them $10,000, they cannot afford anything above $10,000, so they can only buy what you give them or what you allow them to do. When these standards were set, in-ear hearing aid weren't yet available. But we are talking about a matter of more than 10 years. Why aren't you keeping up with the times? Why aren't you offering them something reasonable? By giving them a proper hearing aid, you can at least ease their pain. Their hearing would not come back, or the loss of hearing. Even if you give them the best hearing aid, their hearing would not improve. However, at least a good headset or ear set can allow them to socialize and talk to others. I'm extremely dissatisfied with the compensation levels, but it's extremely difficult to force the government to do calculations again. The government said after passing this ordinance, you would conduct a review. However, the current term administration only has months to go. I would not believe that you have any time to complete the review. But of course, if you establish a framework, it's better than nothing. If work can be implemented before the end of the current term, then there's still some hope, or else it would just be empty talk. We should not stand in the way of the new compensation levels under the ODCO, but I want to tell the government that the compensation levels are disgraceful. They are utterly inappropriate for people who have lost their hearing. Even if you offer them an allowance for a hearing aid, you can never compensate for the incapacity caused on them.
Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I now invite the Secretary for Labour and Welfare to reply. The debate will come to a close after he has replied. Secretary for Labour and Welfare. Madam Deputy, I once again thank Dr. Kwokaki for his valuable comments. I want to emphasize that we will carefully consider the comments made by Dr. Kwok. And I'd also like to briefly respond to the point about raising the compensation for loss of permanent loss of earning capacity from 60% to 100%. The OCDO provides for compensation for people suffering from noise-induced deafness by reason of employment. In terms of the condition, the period is quite long until total deafness, and therefore the earning capacity may not be immediately affected. Comparing to Ontario in Canada, Singapore, New South Wales, Australia, and New Zealand, we have we also have the loss of earning capacity set at 35% to 60%, and comparing to that, Hong Kong's threshold is at 60%, is not too low. I want to emphasize that the government attaches great importance to the situation, and we have a mechanism on a once every 2 years. We will review the compensation amount under the ordinances so as to reflect changes of price and wage, and also to provide sufficient protection to the victims. And for the injured employees, in order to better protect them, we have also proposed to adjust the two compensation amounts in line with the PPCIA index. And in fact, this proposal is endorsed by the ODCB, Occupational Deafness Compensation Board, and also the LAB and the Panel on Manpower. In future, if the compensation amounts have to be adjusted again, we will take into account the views of stakeholders and members, and we'll also consider the views of the Occupational Deafness Compensation Board, the Labour Advisory Board, and also members of the Panel on Manpower. I urge members to support the resolution so as to enhance the protection for OD persons as early as possible. And I put the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Secretary for Labour and Welfare be passed. I now put the question to you as stated. Will those in favour please raise your hands? Those against, please raise your hands. I think the question is agreed by the majority of members present. I declare the motion passed.